Hello everyone and welcome to A Foreigner Farming in the Philippines. Just the foreigner again tonight. I'm going to do part two of basically my life and how I ended up in the Philippines. I wanted to apologize if the light, I'm in the bedroom. I apologize if the lighting is not great in here. I'm kind of escaping from the dogs. Hopefully we'll be able to make the video tonight without too many interruptions. I haven't caught up on all the comments from the video, the first part of this video, but just to let everyone know that this mole on my forehead here has been checked by a doctor several years ago. There's a name for it. It's not cancerous, it's just a mole. I did have some on my back that they took biopsies of, and they were all benign. So don't worry, I'm in okay shape. Wanted to clear up a few things that I didn't mention from the first video, and that I got some dates wrong. Before I started the ice cream trucks, I did have two different jobs cooking, actually three. I worked at a restaurant, a fast food restaurant called Carl's Jr.'s, two different times. Once when I was going to college for about a year, and then again several years later in the winter after my first divorce. And I was a cook at a truck stop and a cook at a mom and pop diner, small restaurant. I was also an avocado salesman. I forget all the jobs that I had. I think I added them all up one time. And sorry if the camera's jerking around. I've got it on a little pedestal in here. I added up all the jobs that I had in my life, and it was like in the 30s, 35 or something, and that in itself is not that common. But when you consider that I was also an ice cream man, I started the ice cream truck business in 1986 when my first daughter was born, and quit this year. So what is that, 32 years, and actually ran that business for all those years except for four, I think. So I did a lot of things in my misspent youth. That 5-year period from 6-year period when I graduated from high school until I got married and started the ice cream trucks was, I had a good time. My cousin and I, young man, I was much thinner, had all my hair, made decent enough money when I was working, and I had a good time. My cousin Tim and I shut down every bar within 50 miles of where we lived at some point or another. Not really a part of my life that I'm proud of, but I sold those wild oats and glad I got it out of my system. I came back from Las Vegas. I think I'd said it was in 95. It was more like 98, I'm thinking. And my father was getting pretty ill. My father, Charlie, rest his soul, he had his first heart attack when he was 57. He was born in 1926. Again, I'm not going to figure out what year that was. And he had mitral valve prolapse, which is a problem with one of his valves in his heart. And he had countless heart attacks, but he lived to be 87, almost 87. He was what they call a thin mouse. He was always tall and thin, much unlike myself. And thin people tend to live longer. He smoked for 78 years. He eventually had throat cancer and had his vocal cords removed. Talked with a little buzzer, But he had bouts with skin cancer. That's why I bring up that I diligently check. He had skin cancer several times because he was a farmer, always worked outside, always out in the sun. He always wore a hat, but still, when you're out in the sun as much as he was, you're prone to getting skin cancer, and he did several. I had the throat cancer. When I came back in 2000, he was in his 70s. I missed him. It's not that he was so sick, but I missed him. And I was single at the time. He had been single for 30 or 40 years. He never remarried after my parents divorced. And he was my best buddy, and I was tired of Las Vegas and just came back and started up the ice cream trucks again, and we lived together most of that time after I came back. I ran the ice cream trucks up until March, I went back in March of this year and ran them up until July, July 6th, I officially closed it down. I sold a few of the trucks. Still have a few. There's still for sale, but it's hard to sell them in the winter time or when the season's ending. This next spring, I'm sure the remaining two will be much easier to sell. How did I end up in the Philippines? Why did I pick the Philippines? Why did I ever explore it? A business associate. I had the trucks parked in a commercial building with many shops in it, and one of the people that had a mechanic shop nearby, and he had a Filipino wife, and knew them well, saw them every day. She was always talking up the Philippines. Started chatting online, and eventually came here. I did the usual research online because I like to kind of figure out what's going on and what I want to do. I try to make a plan. My father died in February. Of 2000 and 14, I think. Can't really remember. Not something I want to remember. And we were close. He was really sick the last few years. I stayed with him. I took care of him. And I knew that. I knew even before he passed, because it was, it was an imminent thing for several months. That because we had been around in this community together for decades, and I just knew myself that everywhere that I went, I would see him. We went to that restaurant, we did the framing on that house, we set tile in that business. I knew there would just be too many memories. Although they're good ones, it was still pretty fresh and pretty raw, and I just didn't want to be in that area, and I knew that I was going to go somewhere, and the Philippines just kind of came up. I started chatting online, met Maricel online. We'll make a separate video on how we met and how that whole thing progressed. But I came over here, and I my first trip here was a month-long visit. I got to look around. Miriam's family, my friend's wife, Miriam, her family is from Lila. It's on the southern end of Bohol. Came, looked around. I tell everyone, and it's kind of true. I was sitting there at her. We stayed at her sister's family's house. And I was sitting out on the front porch one day, smoking a cigarette, drinking some kind of a soda, and I heard this shh in the distance, coming closer. And I couldn't imagine what it could be, and I looked up, and there were two guys riding on a motorcycle. And the guy behind had tucked under his arm, I don't know, four or five pieces of rebar, form bar. And they were just dragging them on the street, just going along. They were going like 30 miles an hour and taking them wherever they had to take them. And I just thought to myself then, because I'm kind of a hillbilly myself, you know, if they're dragging form bar on the street and nobody cares, and then I found the place that I'm gonna call my home. And I think part of the reasoning behind that is that my father was born in 1926, and his father was born in 1891, and his father was born in 1860, 59 or 60, I can't remember. My daughter Sarah could probably tell me, she has the family tree all researched. So four generations spanning 170 years or so kind of makes me old school by definition. I just, you know, it's often said that you come to the Philippines and the clock has turned back 50 years. I think just on some genetic level, this is where I feel comfortable. And not only from wanting to get away from so many visual memories of my father, it was getting really difficult to operate a business in California, near impossible. The amount of capital outlay, the beginning of every year that I had to put out to license, register, insure the trucks, was just getting out of hand. I made $50,000 or $60,000 a year all through the 90s, and in 2018 I was still making the same money. When you have employees and you can pay them $100 a day, that's okay money in 1990, but in 2017, $100 a day in the United States is not a great salary. And it was getting incredibly difficult to find competent and or reliable employees. I mean, it was just like going to the dentist. It was almost impossible to make it happen. And I had been doing it over 30 years, and I was just burnt out on it. I was tired of it. And, you know, you can, as I said in the previous videos, I get bored with stuff pretty quick. And it's pretty amazing that I stuck with it that long. I really don't want to get into politics on our channel. But the political climate in 2015 and 2016 was just so hateful. Hateful in the United States. Whatever political party that you are, Republican or Democrat, it doesn't matter to me. The dynamics have changed in the United States so much that it's like you're not allowed to disagree with someone. You're not allowed to have a differing point of view, and if you do, you're basically the devil. I remember in high school civics class, our teacher dividing us up into groups, and a group of five or six students would represent an imaginary country, and there was five or six of those, and we were given a manifesto of what our country was about and what we believed in, and the only rule was is that we couldn't go to war. And these were diametrically opposed points of view. But we were instructed to find a way to get along. And we did in this hypothetical situation. And it's just to the point in the United States now that the nation itself is so polarized, conservative against liberal, and you can't be one without being vilified by the other. And it's a pretty sad state of affairs. Whichever political bent that you have, I just don't understand why people can't be inclusive. And it was so bitter and so contentious, and I didn't like it, didn't want to be around it, didn't want to be involved in it. The business climate was horrible. And for me, personally, the kids were grown. The grandkids were around, seven of which I have. But I'd worked pretty hard as a father, and I just thought it was me time. It was time for me to do what I had always wanted to do. And that was farm and have a little restaurant. And it was something that I knew that I couldn't do in the States. Property was too expensive in Northern California where I was at. Just to set up a hamburger shop kitchen is $30,000 or $40,000, $50,000 US. The hoods, the fryers, all the equipment could easily run into $100,000. Not the kind of money that I wanted to spend without a guaranteed return. It was just time for me to move on. And the Philippines turned into that place to move to. I was never really interested in any other country, curious about them, but not really interested to move there. And as it turns out, I lucked out. The Philippines, I really, really love this country. You know, there's always a few little things that irritate you. I'm not going to get into them. No one has a perfect life. It's a different culture to assimilate to, go along and get along, and I really like it here. I found my niche. I'm quite sure I found the woman I'm going to spend the rest of my life with, and I enjoy what I do every day. I'm a little bit tired and droopy-eyed today because I'm missing Maricel pretty good. I didn't sleep. I think I got like 4 hours of sleep last night because I just kept waking up. I couldn't sleep. And had a full day today. I probably should have waited till tomorrow to make this video, but I just wanted to get it out of the way. So that's kind of why I ended up here. And I'm sure that I'll go back to the U.S. occasionally to visit. Probably the end of next year I'll be heading back. But it's not the place I want to live. I know a lot of Filipinas watching this, they still have that vision of America as a land of dreams and opportunities, and it's much less so these days. I tell all the Filipinos that will listen. Sure, you make more money there, but it costs more to live, and at the end of the month, you don't have any more to show for your labor than you would if you were here. Certainly not if you were working as an overseas foreign worker. It's so hard to. From a business standpoint, it's hard to get started. It's hard to stay afloat. It's just not a friendly business climate. And you know, there's rules and regulations in the Philippines like anywhere else, and there's probably as many here as there is anywhere else. But quite often in the province here where I'm at, nobody cares. I just like it here. Yeah, there's much more freedom here. You don't realize how restricted you are, how constricted you are in the States until you're not there for a while. I couldn't imagine living in the city in a condominium where you'll get a letter taped to your door if you hung your wet jacket out to drip dry on your balcony. Where they come and ask you why is there a second car parked where you're at. You have to ask permission to grow a tree, cut down a tree. Maybe you like your grass a half inch longer than your neighbor. Well, you got to get permission to grow it. It's just the constraints on a person, especially in a city in the United States, it's something that I cannot and will not deal with. I like it here, and I'm going to stay here. And I guess I'm just going to finish it up on that. Thank you, everyone. Please like, comment, share, and subscribe.